Welcome to Rocky Top, the Tennessee River, a watery graveyard for the goalposts of Tennessee's victory over Alabama. And tonight, another SEC showdown inside a jam-packed Neyland Stadium. The undefeated third-ranked Volunteers against the 19th-ranked Wildcats of Kentucky. Welcome to ESPN College Football Primetime, presented by Subway, in this presentation of the SEC on ESPN. 118th beating Kirk Herbstreit, only the third time and the first since 51 when they're both ranked. The all-black look for the Volunteers, who say they're not looking ahead to Georgia. They got Kentucky on their mind tonight.
Yeah, the ultimate sandwich game with what went on 2 weeks ago against Alabama. Historical win. All the talk about Athens next week, and in between, a very physical Kentucky Wildcat team tonight here in Knoxville.
Celebrating the 50th season of night games here. There were years of quiet fall Saturdays around here. Those are gone. Electric. Tennessee, Kentucky, high stakes in the SEC coming up. Tennessee and Kentucky, border rivals. There is some mutual disdain if you speak to fans and players on both sides. Chris Fowler, Kirk Herbstreit, Holly Rowe. Very hyped to be with you here in primetime in Tennessee. Contrast in styles, Kirk, is going to be very interesting. Tennessee is going to get the football first. Mark Stoops won the toss and deferred, so you'll see the high-speed Hendon Hooker-led offense right away here.
High speed is right. This is one of those offenses, if you're at home, just get ready. May not see a lot of replays. They go fast.
Chance Bohr boots it away for the Wildcats. It's a line drive, fielded right there, and a touchback. So here comes Hendon Hooker, who came from Virginia Tech. He's a second-generation quarterback. His dad was an All-American, NCANT. Allen is actually Hendon's actual first name. At Virginia Tech, he kind of lost the starting job at the end of 20, came here just in the time for Jeremy Pruitt to get fired. Had to wait for Josh Heupel to arrive. He was the backup to Joe Milton. Now he's taken over.
Yeah, Joe Milton wins the job last year when they break camp. He ends up getting hurt, but all through that, still leader in the locker room. Still a guy that was not getting discouraged by not having the job. And then once he stepped in and that injury, he took over and hasn't looked back.
Looking to throw to Jalen Hyatt. Man who lit up Alabama with 5 touchdown receptions. And the good news is for this Tennessee receiving corps, Cedric Tillman returns, Kirk, after missing 4 games with a high ankle.
Yeah, it's great to see him back. He's really the leader in that room. Big physical receiver that they would get the ball too often. Here he is.
He's got it right now. Crowd gave a huge roar when he was introduced as a starter tonight.
Boy, right into that boundary. We saw this Tennessee offense a couple weeks ago against the Nick Saban Alabama defense have a lot of success into the boundary, a lot of movement, creating matchups for Jalen Hyatt against the safety, DeMarco Hyams. And that's what Kentucky's trying to guard against.
On 3rd and 2, Hooker from the pocket delivers a dart across the middle, and it's caught for a first down. Tillman, 2 quick catches, and they move the sticks, and now they'll really crank that tempo up.
Yeah, once they get that first down, again, this is, to me, we'll talk more about it, but it goes back to Art Briles and those Baylor offenses that used to go very, very similar. You can see the 2x2 formation right now, stretch you sideline to sideline.
Jabari Small, very short, but surprisingly physical back, takes it for about 4 yards. He might be about 5'9", but he's thick.
He is. They use both Small and Wright.
Hooker, well protected. Wide open is Hyatt running free. A total bust and a quick strike for the Volunteers. Touchdown reception of the season for Hyatt. This from 55 yards. Man, do they stress the defense.
Yeah, you practice all week. You know you're going to be stretched sideline to sideline, which creates those vertical seams. You come up with a plan, and then you get hit in the mouth, and you got to make adjustments. They do it every single week to everybody they play.
Jace McGrath, transfer from USC, boots it right through. Five plays, 75 yards.
Let's watch this safety right here. You've got two defensive backs, you've got two receivers, but watch the safety get caught up and worried about the crosser. He needs to get depth. Instead, he comes up to worry about that crosser. By coming up, nobody is on the back end of that defense. Again, they come up with a formation and a way to attack. The corner is playing man-to-man. The safety instead comes down to help with Valentine. And it's just a bust in coverage. Like I said, when they come at you with that tempo as fast as they do, it affects your communication. And you bust very often in the back end. How many times did we see Alabama bust against this offense 2 weeks ago?
Oh, J.J. Weaver is an edge player, a linebacker. He's involved in trying to cover high at that time by himself.
Yeah.
And that's a predictable result.
Those formations, every coach tries to come up with an answer. Like I said, it's a different offense, but where we first saw it years ago with Art Briles, when those offenses could run the football and throw, they make you determine with those formations if you're going to commit to stopping the pass or load up to stop against the run. And wherever you load up, they're going to go the other direction.
A very short kickoff. This won't get near Barry and Brown, and received on a hop there by one of the up guys, and Tennessee swarms and knocks him down short of the 25. Jatan McLean, a running back, couldn't make the 20. Here comes Will Levis, tough physical dude playing with a variety of injuries. Kirk, he operates this pro style offense.
Yeah, you said it, I've said it, said it all week. Most intriguing aspect of this matchup is Levis gets a lot of the attention, but really it's Chris Rodriguez being back, suspended for 4 games. They're returning running back. They're a physical offense. 3 tight ends, 2 tight ends. They want to try to chew clock. They want to run the ball. They want to win the line of scrimmage, keep Hendon Hooker on the sideline.
Rodriguez running behind what they call the big blue wall, but he ends to a brick wall of black jerseys. Latrell Bumpus got him. Here's the Chick-fil-A impact players of the Wildcats have the football.
Talking about Chris Rodriguez, 24. He's a physical back, has a great feel for their zone package. Tavian Robinson, 9. Good to see him back. He's missed the last couple games. He'll be in the slot. Trevon Flowers is a leader, leads them in tackles. And then Byron Young, when they drop back to throw, keep an eye on 6 off the edge. Does a really good job at applying pressure. Has 3.5 sacks on the year.
Rodriguez again testing the middle, but it's going to produce a 3rd and long. Aaron Beasley, the middle backer, got him.
Yeah, these linebackers have heard all week that they've got to come downhill, get downhill, get downhill, beat these double teams before they can get up to you. And that's what Beasley does right there, Chris. Gets downhill, doesn't allow that guard tackle combo block to climb up to him. They're asserting themselves, and they got this crowd behind them, which you and I haven't been here. We've been here for game day and different things, but to be here in a primetime setting, this is about as good as it gets if you're a college football fan. This is wild in here right now.
It's not that good for the visitors, though,
no,
at the moment.
No.
3rd and 10, play clock at 2. Got to hurry, just get it off. Levis has time to pump and fire over the middle, but it's incomplete. Tried to squeeze the ball in there to Barrian Brown, the freshman, and the Cats go 3 and out.
He worked back, showed good patience. He wants to just eventually work back to Barrian Brown, the freshman. But watch his eyes. He's looking left, and then eventually he'll come back to his right. But look how he's late. He's open. Throw it, throw it, throw it. Late. By the time he makes that throw, the defense made it tough on him. If he could have recognized that and let it rip, he had a first down.
So Colin Goodfellow to punt it. D. Williams, the Volunteers punt returner, is dangerous. It's a line drive kick that checks up, and Williams will just let it roll dead at about the 37. So a dream start for the Volunteers. A quick touchdown, and they get the football back after a 3 and out.
Well, let's go back to that first drive with Tennessee when they stretched this Kentucky defense. What they do, they're going to stretch you horizontally. Make those safeties. Look at the safeties coming up. Got to make a tackle. Got to help out. And then they lull you to sleep off play action. Same thing. Safeties this time come up, and they go right by you. They constantly challenge and stress the eyes of the safeties and the edge defenders of any defense they go up against.
It's a party already. The AT&T 5G Skycam shows it. In Lexington last year, Tennessee scored on the first play of the game, scored again on the fourth play.
It's
right their way to the third play.
It's almost like weathering the storm, right? And there's DeAndre Square, the leader of this defense, going into the locker room. We'll keep a close eye on that with Holly. But, you know, early in this game, this crowd is so wild, and this offense gets him so excited. It's Kentucky just trying to, as you would say, break a serve here, you know, just try to get a stop and settle into the game. Johnny Mack would say that, not you.
Tillman? Short gain. I like the tennis analogy. It's more like boxing. They just hit it with a right cross.
You're right.
And they're staggered, and you just got to get your faculties
get
back.
Get your bearings. I got to get a holding call. That's about the only thing that can maybe slow Tennessee down here.
Penalties have been a problem.
Pass interference, offense number 88. 15-yard penalty for the previous spot. Repeat first down.
Got big Princeton fan as a tight end fullback. Occasional pass thrower. Last week threw a touchdown pass.
And at the bottom, you see the big tight end they have stretched out there, just trying to make a block. I think Josh Heupel's saying he's behind the line of scrimmage there. Bill, what do you think?
Yeah, I don't have him behind the line, so it's tight, but I wouldn't call that.
Okay. That's why Josh was upset, but they get the call.
So first and 25. Against an offense this good, you get an opportunity. Backed up this far, you feel like you got to get off the field.
Oh, yeah.
Kentucky. Well, play action. Hooker fires across the middle, and it's incomplete. That was inaccurate. Throwing a little bit behind Brew McCoy. Holly?
Well, guys, DeAndre Square, the three-time team captain for Kentucky, has gone to the locker room with a right ankle injury. Not sure yet if he will return or not. In his place, though, a talented sophomore, Trevin Wallace, number 32. They said he has all the tools to be great, and he'll play a lot. So a good replacement for Square right now.
Yeah, but the guy you'd least want off the field.
Yes.
He makes the calls. He communicates. He's the leading tackler on this defense. And Small running up the middle, so it's going to be third and long.
That's the thing again. The passing game gets all the attention, but truly the running game is what makes this offense so tough to defend, because you can't just pay attention to Hendon Hooker and the way they stretch you out on the perimeter. Look at your bottom left. I mean, they're quite a production when they change plays, and we'll show you this throughout the game.
And there's a misfire. Slow down on third down, won't they, to try to get the right play against the right look.
Yeah, the fake clap. Try to see two high safety look, one high. Just trying to get a feel for the coverage. He did it.
Penalty on Fant here.
Yeah, he did it twice, and I think Fant wasn't expecting that second one. Kent's. It's funny. He's going over to talk to the coaches, but with the sheets that they have pulled up over, you can't really see them in discussion. Now they've got him behind the sticks with the penalties.
Way behind the sticks.
Yeah. With this offense, you never know.
Third and 24. Another flag comes out. It's caught on the carom by Tillman. He's way short of the first down, but this flag was near the quarterback.
Yes. Except
they're signaling holding.
Left tackle. Crawford just grabbed another holding call. It's a good sign for Kentucky getting enough pressure to get these holds.
On the offense, number 53. 2-yard penalty, previous spot.
You just go, they're going to take the penalty?
Yeah, they're going to keep pushing him. But there's the hold right there. Just grabs on with that right hand. Pretty obvious.
It was fourth down, though. Okay. What do you got in third and 34? I know it's an explosive offense, Coach. But
I think it's more about field position.
So three penalties in this sequence for the Volunteers. After flawless execution in the first three plays. Kentucky with everybody back. Only one guy with his hands on the ground. And Hooker, who can run, is going to take off, but he's going to take a hit. at the 20, and that was a disastrous sequence for the Volunteers. They'll punt it away.
What we just talked about when Kentucky took the field defensively, what you wanted to do against Hooker, it's just survive the early gauntlet that they put you in with the speed, the tempo, the crowd, everything that goes into this, and the way Josh Heupel's team can just jump on top of you, and they do come up with a stop with the assist of the holding calls and the penalties that set them back.
Volunteers punted three times total in their first three SEC games. So it's a rare appearance. Paxton Brooks boots it high. And Treaty to make the fair catch at the 38-yard line. That's good hang time. So the Cats, after the 52-yard punt, take over down 7.
ESPN College Football Primetime is presented by Subway. Try the all-new Subway Series menu. Your pick of 12 irresistible subs.
Victory Cigars, that's pretty sweet. When Jalen Hyatt caught 5 against the Tigers to smoke a cigar with Peyton Manning. As field rushes go, this was off the charts.
Man, that's as wild a scene, and they're taking that goalpost not to a local establishment. They're going to throw that into the river.
Absolutely.
I've never seen that.
Yeah, there it is. Google Maps, the Neyland Stadium goalpost right down there. They got new ones back up. It's been a long time coming, man. Some of these Tennessee players, most of them, in fact, weren't born the last time he beat Alabama back in 2006. That was a long time coming, that victory cigar and that celebration.
I feel like the last great Tennessee team, obviously not the 98, but 98's a given. 01 was a really good team and came close to getting to the national title, too.
Rodriguez tries to find some space at the left side and shows that power and drives for about 6. Holly?
The good news is that Tennessee really believed in themselves and had already started construction on a new pair of goalposts that they installed on Thursday before last week's game. But shout out to the surface management crew. They were here till 2 o'clock in the morning trying to get this field cleaned up. There were ashes, glass, bottles, sunglasses. They had to vacuum it up with air dryers. They had to really work hard to get the playing surface back to what it is right today. So shout out to the Tennessee surface management team for getting the playing surface back after the crowd rushed the field.
It's a lot of stuff. Levis on the bootleg, flips it over the middle, and the ball is deflected. And the tight end running free. The pass was knocked down there by Jalen McCullough.
And McCullough back after the one game suspension. Watch him sit back here. He starts to come up, and then he uses his eyes to watch the quarterback. Looks like he's going to move him out to the outside. Instincts bring him back to the inside and almost comes up with an interception by reading the eyes of Levis, who brought him back to the other receiver.
McCullough is a story. He's missed the last couple games. There's still an outstanding felony aggravated assault charge, but the authorities at Tennessee, everybody involved here seems to believe that his account of things means that he should be allowed to play, and they're happy to have him back. He's a key leader in that secondary. 3rd and 3. Levis complete across the middle, just sitting down in that route. Catch made by Dane Key, the freshman.
Well, this time with the pressure here, they bring pressure, they drop. Here's your receiver. Watch how much more decisive he is. There's that middle linebacker blitzing. He just settles right into the soft spot underneath that zone on 3rd and short. Got a couple different freshmen. Brown, you'll see tonight, too. And this time it's Dane Key, the bigger target at 6'3".
Levis has been really efficient this year converting on 3rd down, whether it's 3rd and short, 3rd and medium, even 3rd and long. He's been an accurate passer in those situations. Off the play action, Levis looking to take a shot and just lofts it downfield, and it's brought perfectly into the hands of Jordan Dingle. An explosive tight end.
I consider this almost like 13 personnel. You got a tight end here, you got a tight end here, tight end in the backfield, and they just try to hide him and then sneak him down. Dingle, sneak him down out of the backfield and get him in a matchup that he can win. How about the throw there by Levis, putting it up in the air where the big fella Dingle can adjust and get underneath that, not giving the defender Flowers much of a chance at all at the ball.
Dingle from Bowling Green, Kentucky. You saw him play some fullback. He can flex out. Receiver, tight end. What a throw by Levis. Rodriguez bangs forward. He just seems to fall forward with 2 or 3 yards every time.
Well, and that's what they missed early in the year during that four-game suspension. Wherever, whatever was blocked, that's where they would get tackled. There's very little yards after contact, and you get him inserted back to the lineup. I feel like these last couple weeks, you're starting to see him really become the back that we know he can be. In fact, last week, 31 carries, 197 yards, 31 carries. You don't see that very often in college football anymore by one back.
Of course, missing those games means that he's fresh for this stretch run. Missed the first four. He's got it again. And he's got a first down. You talk about yards after. Yards before contact, they don't have a lot of them here.
Right.
They don't create huge creases, do they?
Not at all. And this is a zone play Chris designed here. Here's the vision to bring it back. That's why these backside blocks are so important. He's going to run this to the left. Vision brings it back to the right. Great blocking on the backside. Jeremy Flax, who's back in the lineup. And how about the true freshman, Josh Caddis, the big tight end out of Cincinnati Moeller, with a great block to help spring that open.
They have a top 10 rush defense, but don't know if they've been tested by a running attack quite like Kentucky's. Rodriguez again on first down off the left side. Stiff arm, has the edge. Barrels outside at the 1 yard line. Getting a taste of this Kentucky attack.
You got Bates right here, and you got Caddis, incidentally, again, both from Cincinnati Moeller. They're going to collapse this down to be able to set the edge. And then you got the big offensive lineman pulling around. And then all you need is Rodriguez with that stiff arm. Great job of sealing. Nice stiff arm. Now he's out into the open. What a great drive and an answer here, potentially, by Kentucky now inside the five. See if they can finish it.
Three tight ends. An I formation. Levis on the bootleg. Couldn't get the corner, has to fight back, and he'll lose a yard, but the Volunteers defense not fooled. Amari Thomas got him down.
I know the NFL say don't do this, but I personally, in college football, this tells you everything about the personality of Will Levis. Instead of throwing this away, he goes back into his Penn State days. He lowers his shoulder. That's what he was to Sean Clifford. He was like a bulldozer they would bring in short yardage. He's become a great back. Obviously, they're not going to recommend he do that in the NFL. I just love the personality. The offensive line in this offense feeds off of that kind of attitude from their quarterback.
Rodriguez just walks in. And Kentucky with a powerful answer to Tennessee's lightning strike. And Rodriguez was the workhorse on that drive.
Well, that left side opening things up. Watch the end man, Bates, the tight end. You got Caddis again helping take that safety and corner out. And then you throw that blocking and execution up front. You get maybe an arm tackle on Chris Rodriguez. It's not going to bring him down. That is Kentucky football in a nutshell on that drive right there.
Mark Ruffalo for the point after. That's what you're going to see. That's the contrast in Silas that makes it so fun, and it's blocked. Tennessee gets a hand up and knocks the PAT down. And now trying to make a play here is Jeremy Banks. He's still running, zigging and zagging, but UT's special teams, which struggled early in this season, makes a play to preserve the one-point lead.
Kentucky had some special teams issues against Ole Miss that cost them. And here early in this game, we think they're going to tie this up. Good push in the middle. A nice job of blocking that away.
Looks like Dejon Terry got the big hand up. Good start here in Rocky Top. Contrast and styles of Volunteers score in their third play from scrimmage. Jalen Hyatt, long touchdown pass. And then Kentucky, thanks to some Tennessee penalties, got the football back. And they ground out a 71-yard drive in 9 plays, 5 of them runs by Chris Rodriguez, who ran for 40 on the drive and the touchdown. This PAT is the difference. Jimmy Holiday will let that one sail into the end zone.
Take a look at this. When we were talking about how he scrambles, Amari Thomas hits him, you think about the hit on the shoulder, but also the right hand. See that face mask as he unloads his entire 320 pounds into that quarterback. And then after the touchdown drive, Will Levis goes over to the Kentucky sideline as if he hasn't had enough injuries. Now that's his right hand, his throwing hand. It looks like they're working on, looks like the pinky of that right hand. So we'll keep an eye on that. I don't know if there's anything to keep this guy out of this game.
Left middle figure was injured. He's got a turf toe. He's got a steel plate and shoe. That left shoulder has been ailing.
He's like, let's go, game on.
Small has a crease and makes a cut. Holly, we don't have enough time for the full injury report on Will Levis, but what do you got?
That's right. He's played with a dislocated finger on his non-throwing hand. It's that left shoulder that he took a hard hit on. And Mark Stoops actually told me before the game he was worried that he would try to run the football and lower the shoulder because that's who he is. That's exactly what he did on that touchdown drive. He did not get the left shoulder looked at here on the sideline, but they have cleaned up blood on the right throwing hand. He's fine. He's not even tried to tested out over here yet. Will told me that he is spending about 4 to 5 hours a day in the training room, but he was grateful for the bye week so he could really focus on getting his body healthy. But after the first couple of drives, I think he's going to be back in the training room this week.
Oh, I think he's going to be back in the training room the rest of the year.
Until January, I think.
No one's 100%, especially in this conference this time of year, but he has a very high pain tolerance. I mean,
while you and all the NFL analysts will be breaking down his arm degree and his slot, arm slot, and all that, I'm going to be talking about how tough he is. His leadership, the intangibles that he brings to this position, I think potentially is a game changer, something that can separate him. Forget the NFL. I'm talking about this year, 5-2, ranked 19th in the country. This team really rallies around that leadership and that toughness. When you see your quarterback playing through pain and you got a few pains, you're like, what am I doing? I got to deal with it the way Will is.
Missed the one game against South Carolina, and it was not the same Kentucky football team. That was a struggle without him.
Great to see Square back out there.
We saw Terrell Asian help at the sidelines. He made the tackle, and he's being looked at by the athletic trainers as Small squirts for a first down.
Well, Tennessee now goes back to the running game. They have the numbers to their advantage in that box area. They feel that that's the time that they can win the line of scrimmage and run the football.
Long throw to the field, and that's Brew McCoy, veteran transfer from USC. Kedron Smith on the stop.
It's a yin and yang against Tennessee. Are they going to run it? They're going to throw it. He constantly puts that ball into the running back. And
quarterback can run it too. He pump fake to the edge. That was covered, so Hooker turns it up and gets about two. It'll set up third and four.
And they're trying to set up a block to get the ball out to Jalen Hyatt. But, man, I'll tell you, Andrew Phillips has been inserted today specifically for this offense. He's a backup corner. But to get three corners on the field tonight, they're playing him. And he stepped up and took that away.
And the Volunteers not quite at hyper speed when they need to divert on third down here. Hooker has time. Now takes off. He's going to dive. Not going to get there. Lowered the head, but he stopped a yard and a half short of the first down by De'Eric Jackson, the middle linebacker.
Much better communication downfield in the back end by Kentucky.
He's going for it. They're going for it in their end of the field, and they're going to sneak it to midfield. So Josh Heupel rolling the dice and converting, caught the Cats off guard there.
They caught Mark, and there's Mike Stoops. Everybody off guard, including the players. They're looking around trying to get the call, and the ball snapped.
And now taking a shot. Hyatt winning a battle, and the crowd wants a flag. They don't. Now one comes out. Andrew Phillips was in coverage. The official nearest to it, the side judge, didn't throw the flag. But there is a marker down.
Well, we just talked about Phillips in that nickel spot, that slot corner.
His pass interference.
That's what they're going to call, but I thought. Bill, I don't know how you feel. I felt that Hyatt sold that really well. Yeah, they're hand to hand, but he went down. And I don't know. I don't really think that Phillips pushed him down.
I think I disagree with you respectively, but I've got the forearm into him, caused him to go off balance. The discussion was probably about catchable or not catchable.
Right.
He gets the benefit of the doubt.
Respectful disagreement is perfectly okay.
Especially when it comes to pass interference.
Disrespectful disagreement. We're okay with that too. If you
we encourage
first and ten. This is Small darting for about four. It's the weirdest game last year in Lexington. Tennessee had the ball 17 minutes. 17 minutes. Right. And won a shootout. Small this time makes a cut and is knocked down at the 21.
Kentucky continuing to struggle to get set up against this tempo.
Alex Golish works calling the plays, and he professes to, you know, love running the football. You said it, that the passing game gets all the hype and the heat, but
yeah,
it's really a running offense.
Oh yeah, yeah. They pride themselves on that physicality. Like I said, if the numbers are right, you see big Darnell Wright went down, and Hendon Hooker's like, we don't have time for that. You got to get up.
Hooker scrambles, has some space, and going to kind of high step his way out of bounds at the 15-yard line. J.J. Weaver chased him out.
I think the thing, and we're going to show the Kentucky staff on the sidelines. They practice all week on getting the calls in. These players are looking over to make sure that they get the call. And you know, it's about getting your cleats underneath you and being ready to play.
Third and four, and Small's going to be stopped again. So another fourth and one here. We even presume the offense stays on the field.
Oh, I think that's a given, right?
They made their 13th fourth down conversion of the season at 18 tries at midfield in this possession. Small again easily makes the first and goal. And in the red zone, Tennessee has been scary good, almost perfect this year.
What a great formation where you put the tight end Jacob Warren instead of out on the edge. You just line him up right behind the right tackle. And you just run right behind him.
Small again. 39 red zone trips. They have scored 32 touchdowns, kicked 6 field goals. The only empty red zone trip was with the backups in against UT Martin last week.
That's right. That's right. Hey, you see Heupel's energy? They actually have to substitute. So now when they substitute, now Kentucky can finally get some players substituted in themselves. There for about 4 or 5 plays, Tennessee was not taking any players out, so they could go as fast as they wanted, and they had this Kentucky defense on the ropes.
He took out Cedric Tillman, who's still working his way back, working the rust off. Keaton's in for him, and Jalen Wright spells Small here, second and goal. Hooker in the flat, caught. Jacob Warren knocked down about the 1.5 yard line by Zion Childress on what probably is the last play of the first quarter, unless they snap it real fast. It's third and goal. Now, can't quite get the playoff before time runs out here in the first quarter. So the fast and furious Volunteers, the grinding methodical Wildcats. Good first quarter here. End of one on ESPN College Football Primetime from Knoxville. Set for the second quarter, ESPN College Football Primetime, presented by Subway. This presentation of the SEC and ESPN. Mark Stoops was irate. He wanted a piece of every official down there at the end of the first quarter, and he was demonstrating right there, Kirk, where he felt Josh Heupel was way out of the coaching box to call plays in that last sequence.
That went on pretty much the entire commercial break. I mean, and Josh Heupel, he's heavily involved. Outside, there's the official coming over. This will be good. This will be fun. He's, by the way, he's right back out on the field.
He was pointing to the clock saying the quarter's over, but you still can't go out there when there's still time on the clock. So third and goal from the 2. Princeton Fant is in the backfield. Big fella can run it, catch it, throw it. This time he just walks in. Old school fullback touchdown for this Tennessee offense. And that was all about the ground. 15 play drive, 13 runs.
They give Kentucky a little bit of their own medicine there, like you said, Chris, with the big tight ends. It's the thing. I mean, there's more variety to this offense than you think, than just the old Baylor 2x2 on both sides of the offensive line.
Fan had a couple touchdown runs last week against UT Martin and also threw a 66-yard touchdown pass to Hyatt.
Let's go back because we don't have a chance to show you a lot of these replays. Looks like we have a flag on the extra point.
Holding on the kicking team, number 85. 10-yard penalty from previous spot. Replay the try.
Fan has run it four times. All four have been touchdowns. He won the contest. Which first receiver non-quarterback can throw it the farthest? And he got the honor of throwing that pass to Hyatt last week. And it's something to put on tape to give opponents a pause. Josh is out in the field again.
Yeah. Yeah.
Where is the get back coach? On the sideline?
I don't think he has one.
So McGrath. Long extra point here. And just slid it wide. So the penalty is costly. It looked like the snap and the hold were not cleanly executed. So both teams having trouble with the PAT, and the lead is 7.
This is the fourth down. The confusion just trying to get the call in. Quarterback sneak. Kentucky not quite lined up. So that gave him a chance to continue. This is the interference where Bill and I disagree. I thought Jalin Hyatt sold it pretty well. He gets the call. And then here's the touchdown. Boy, that right side of that offensive line, the tackle, Darnell Wright. Nice job of those tight ends helping their tight end friend Fant into the end zone for the touchdown.
This is what happened. Yeah, the snap was kind of low and timing thrown off. And McGrath kicked one of the most important field goals in Tennessee history, the sidewinder to beat Alabama. Can't get that one through, and they're sitting at a 7-point lead. Interesting response to Kentucky's long physical drive. Tennessee sort of out of character, but certainly not beyond their abilities to find it out on the ground.
Something to keep an eye on for Tennessee. It would be 22 plays, you know, in that first quarter. I mean, if you continue at that pace, you're out on the field for over 80 snaps, and that's a huge advantage for Heupel and what Tennessee wants to do in trying to wear you down.
And the kick will bounce out of bounds, so it's a penalty on Paxson Brooks. Who's the punter and the holder. That's a tough sequence for him. Let's go to Matt Berry for an update. Hey, Matt.
Chris Fowler, good evening. Herbie, hello. Weighing in on Ole Miss, Texas A&M here. Ole Miss scored their first possession. Connor Wegman and Moose Muhammad ties this game 7 apiece. That over on SEC Network. Arizona, USC tied at 10 until Caleb hits Brendan Rice here to take a 17-10 lead. And that one over on Pac-12.
Keep you posted. So Kentucky from the 35 once again in the position of trying to answer a Tennessee touchdown.
And that last drive that Kentucky had the ball, they went back to the bread and butter of going to a lot of 12 and 13 personnel sets with those big tight ends.
Rodriguez, instant penetration, spun down right at the line of scrimmage. Really no chance there. Wesley Walker got in.
Again, watch the linebackers. They know that this is a team that wants to be able to establish things up front. What I love is because the backers are getting down there, this defensive line, at least on that play, much better job of getting off the point of contact, using their hands and slipping off these blocks. Boy, if you get, even though Levis is very talented, just the system that they run, you get these guys behind the sticks, it's a whole different game. It's a Kentucky offense that their goal tonight is convert 65% of their third downs. They feel that they can sustain drives and again keep Hooker on the sideline if they can do that.
And pressure came in. He just throws it at the ground. Those second down plays really become important to avoid this third and 10. They're not built for third and 10.
It's just not a scheme that where they feel comfortable in doing that. This is an offense that has a lot of talent, but they are all about running the football and setting up play action, staying on schedule, second and 6, third and 2. You get them into this position, wouldn't be surprised at all to see Tennessee dial up with an exotic look to try to confuse them up front, see if they can get after Will Levis.
It's a lot of the quarterback's platter in this offense. Pro style. Empty backfield. Volunteers rush 5. Levis launching. downfield and dropping the football. Coming back, trying to make the play was Tavion Robinson. Nico Slaughter in coverage. That was easily catchable.
Yeah, right there, a little slot fade. And Slaughter never sees the football. A good adjustment in coming back to the ball. And this is their guy, Robinson. This is the matchup they want against Slaughter. Remember, he's been out a couple games, does a great job of coming back, and then the ball just goes right through his arms. But that's a matchup they're going to want to continue to go after every chance that they can, especially when he walks up and plays in press man.
Robinson, a transfer from Virginia Tech. We caught some passes from Hendon Hooker. Fair catch made at the 22-yard line. So quick three and out for the Wildcats, and Tennessee takes over up 7. In the post-Philip Fulmer era, Tennessee right up through last year, kind of a house of horrors. Look at that record in the SEC, 37-69. That's 11th best in the conference. But comes Josh Heupel, who inherited, frankly, a mess. There were 25 guys who hit the portal, and it was a grim place in 2020. They got it going last year. 7 wins, already equaled that total this year.
I think a lot of people thought that Josh Heupel would be able to get it going here. I don't know if anybody thought he would be able to get it going this quickly. And of course, Hendon Hooker coming in to engineer this offensive scheme has helped so much.
Hooker escapes pressure, fooled, flashing DeAndre Square that time, and scoots forward for about a 5-yard gain.
So there's 3 different plays that could happen there. You got an outside stretch play to the right, quick throw to the left, and he gets out of all of it and just runs.
Jalen Wright breaks the tackle, still running. Wright is going to be tracked down deep in Kentucky territory. And that Volunteer ground game is grinding again.
That's a good job by the right side, putting a dent into that defense on a play side. And the backside tackle leading around to clear it out.
35-yard gain for the running back who's gotten more physical. He's made a huge leap up, Jalen Wright.
They're going to take it.
His eligibility means he didn't go down with an elbow or a knee.
They're just checking to see if that knee touch. To me, it wasn't even close, but because they want to make sure.
Ken Williamson, the referee, Stan Murray in charge of the replay booth. But, you know, Wright is a guy that he's a complimentary player to Small. But a dude who has just gotten, you know, a little bit bigger and stronger. Did he keep the knee up? Yeah, easily.
It's not even close.
He's had some fumbling problems. Holding on to the football has been his issue. But he is a pretty good 1-2 punch.
It is.
Along with Small.
See that left tackle pulling around. Crawford. Great job. Again, this defense spread all over the place. And then you got to worry about what's going on inside between these tackles and how physical the combination of these two backs can be. And the quarterback run game to go along with it.
Again, it over just, Tyrell Asian.
It got right over him.
After further review,
it did slow the tempo down, though. Heupel won't be thrilled with that, and the crowd isn't either.
Man, this crowd is just active.
Yes.
They're listening to everything. They have an opinion on everything tonight and every night when they play here at Neyland.
Yes, they do. Well, they had some negative opinions for a lot of years. You got to forgive the euphoria here.
I'm not forgiving. I bow down to it. I love it. It's refreshing. I mean, it is great to see. This is a starving fan base.
Yes, indeed. Hooker delivers far side. Hit immediately after the catch is Tillman. Carrington Ballantyne on the coverage. It's good to see Tillman back out there making a quick contribution. He's still not quite 100%. They said he hit about 90-95% of his top speed in practice this week.
These receivers stretched so far. It really felt like that last play, the receiver ran out of bounds. He's close anyway.
Long throw. McCoy makes the catch and is muscled out. That's another first down near the 17.
Look at this. Maybe he gets pushed. I guess you would see he gets pushed and gets himself back in. So he's able to establish himself back in. Good job by the official seeing that.
That time. Heavy traffic as J.J. Weaver knocked right down.
You know, Hendon Hooker, it's not always as fast as they can go. They try to mix their tempos up, try to keep this defense guessing a bit.
Hyatt motions across. And Hooker flips it across the middle, and the catch is made by Princeton Fant. So I'm running for a touchdown. Now he puts them in position. First and goal.
So you're running the ball so well, these linebackers, no matter how much preparation you did about this pass game, you start getting downhill, they keep you honest. Now with a quick pass right behind you to the tight end.
Fant off to the left. Right is the ball carrier. They fake it to him. Hooker zips it. Catch made by Tillman, who's going to be stopped a yard short by Valentine, who prevented the touchdown. Hooker just got that pass out before he got hit.
Had a double slant to the field. The safety took away the inside slant, so he showed good patience, worked back to the outside, and almost got into the end zone with Tillman.
And on second and goal, right, just bows in. There's a flag down, a pre-snap flag. So hold on a second. Did they move too soon? So it's Jalen Wright who scores. Another long march for the Volunteers. To get 77 in 8 plays. Again, ground oriented drive. Big run by Wright where he ran over Asian and stayed on his feet was the crucial play.
What a drive, a good push. Just leaning on this Kentucky defense, challenging them physically and mentally. Receivers involved in catching the ball and blocking.
ESPN College Football Primetime, presented by Subway, is brought to you by DirecTV. Get your live TV and on-demand favorites together like never before. That means all the entertainment you love in one place. Get your TV together with DirecTV.
General Nealon against Paul Bryant. 7-0 for the Volunteers. A Bryant team that day, Kirk. Ready for this?
Yeah.
12 turnovers. At 12 turnovers in that 7-0 loss. Look at old Jerome Carbo. Oh, headbutt. We scored. And Jerome Mincy said, bro, I don't have a helmet on.
You can't
headbutt me, but I don't have a helmet on.
Carbon's
Jerome just hits whatever's moving.
Anything gets in my way, we're knocking out tonight.
It's John McClain. Stopped just short of the 30. So the Cats take over. Now down 14 to Matt Berry.
All right, here's that Texas A&M offense. We thought we might see Wegman having a good night. Watch this grab by Evan Stewart. That is freshman to freshman. It's 14-7 A&M. However, Ole Miss driving, threatening to score to tie it. And then Israel Abanikanda, Pitt in North Carolina. Panthers on top first, 7-0. Fowler, don't be throwing any jabs at Herbie tonight in the booth.
All good here. Well, Kentucky knew they needed a positive start. They had to weather this energy. This drive is going to have a lot to say about that. You got to try to match Tennessee's score for score. And Rodriguez breaking a tackle, banging off people, runs for about 14.
Really good block there by Burton, the left guard. Just rooted down low and gets a good kick out block. Watch him right here. Just get it nice, quick. Right at the line of scrimmage, able to push him to the outside, and then there's that tough running again by Rodriguez. He's just bouncing off of people.
Levis only completed 2 passes so far, Kirk, tonight. Just 32 yards passing. It's been all about Rodriguez, who's out of the ball game for the moment. Tom McClain spells him. McClain, not quite the power of Rodriguez. Picks up a couple of yards before Elijah Simmons combines on the stop.
Yeah, Rodriguez, you don't see that very often.
No.
Puts his hand up once Mark Stoops right away, just saying, hey, catch your breath here. He means everything to this offense. They're built around him and the offensive line. And like we said, the first four games, he's out. By the way, the first four games with the revolving door, a lot of these positions up front, the offensive line became a weakness because of so many injuries. And the bye week really helped him get ready for this trip.
Levis flips it to McClain, and he's got some space and a block, and he's going to break tackles and still running hard. They couldn't get him to the ground until he gets to the 36-yard line.
So this is what you want to do with McClain. He's got some blockers out front. This is just an extension again of their running game. Get the ball out in space where McClain has a low center of gravity, has good quickness, and I love to see this blocking. You got tight ends downfield. You got wide receivers that are able to contribute and get out there and help. Cummings, number 8, with a good block.
Dane Key, the freshman, working hard on the edge. You fake it to McClain. Levis flips it to the side, and it's Dingle. Makes a cut, and you can see this guy's a big athlete. Once he gets going, he's dangerous in space.
Yeah, and what they do is they move him around. We've seen him line up as a fullback. Now they put him here. You motion him, and Tennessee just loses him. He comes over. Nobody. All eyes in the backfield. Nobody's out there in the flat. Remember, this is a pass defense that's one of the worst in the country. Just the numbers show that. 130th, and there's the big hit that the crowd reacted to. But after, Dingle picks up a first down.
Roman Harrison brought the wood there. Rodriguez is back in the football game. And he's got it again. Makes a cut and earns about 4. Holly?
Well, Chris Rodriguez sitting out that 4-game suspension didn't sit out. Coach Mark Stoops said he wanted to do everything. He asked if he could be on the scout team, and it really helped him because he got tackled, he got live reps, he learned the system, and he stayed in game condition. But it helped us because he was really hard to tackle. The scout team was killing our defense at some points because Chris Rodriguez was not letting up, giving us good looks. So he's come in really hungry to run.
It's an NCAA suspension. It involved a time card on a job, and it did cost him 4 games. But he should be raring to go for the stretch run. Volunteers all over him that time.
Kind of nice to let the broadcast breathe. As fast as this game has been flying with Tennessee's offense, man, let's catch our breath. When Blue's on offense, right?
Two totally different games.
Oh, man.
You got to be great on third down, said Mark. Good won't do it. Got to be great on plays like this one right here.
That's what it's all about. Find the matchup that you can win.
Levis in the slot throws it to Tavion Robinson. He's right at the marker. Is he just short? Fourth down.
Yeah. They're going to go fast here. But they use Caddis here as just kind of on a rub route and bring him underneath.
And Levis sneaking it, using that big frame. He's got the first down, but barely at the 15.
I think he was stopped initially, but because of how big and strong he is, that second, third, maybe fourth effort ends up getting the first down. That was not easy. Look at the big fella coming up, waving that arm, saying he got a first down, but that was not easy. There was not much of a push at all by this offensive line. They try to go hurry up. Watch the initial push. Nothing. I mean, look at the offensive linemen. They're down. Levis on the other side of that pile. That's where you see Key reacting to it. This is a great look at it right here. He kind of runs into a wall. He stopped. Look at the legs. He's a big man. And the crowd wants to take a peek at the spot, and they are.
Well, his knees went down. He was trying to get some traction. Where was the football when his knee hit the ground? It's really tough to overturn these rulings on the field in cases like this, just looking through the mass of bodies.
And we couldn't even see that until you saw that second replay. Like I said, I knew he hit a wall, but I thought maybe he stayed up. But after you saw that second replay, you could tell that his knees went down.
We'll bring in Bill here, but can they tell exactly where the ball is, right?
Hopefully on their quad
here,
shot.
Here, the knee is down.
They can do something with a quad shot. But at the same time, indisputable video evidence, tough to say it is.
But he didn't have to get all the way to the 15. That's where they spot the ball.
I was going to say, guys, it's on the 15, but he didn't even where he landed, he was short of the 15. So I don't know how you bring this back, but that, Chris, like you said, when that left knee touched, where was the ball?
Well, they could spot it back a little from where it is and still make a first down.
After further review, the ruling on the field stands. First down.
Yeah, like we said, it's very tough to overturn that.
Yep.
And the crowd not going to love it as they viewed it on the Jumbotron.
If nothing else, it allows Tennessee's defense to regroup a bit. Now we find out the game inside the red zone for Kentucky. And they're an offense that's going to drive the ball and have to get touchdowns, cannot settle for field goals against Hendon Hooker and the Vols offense and how explosive they are.
Vols defense has been stout inside the red zone. One of the better teams in the country. They forced a lot of field goals, and they made three takeaways down here this year in the red zone. Rodriguez toss sweep. Old school SEC. There was a lot of traffic there. He made a nice cut to just get 4 yards.
Well, Tennessee shows team speed there. Good job of forcing him back into where the rest of that defense was. Tamarian McDonald. And that star nickel got outside, and there was nothing that Rodriguez could do. He couldn't get to the edge, couldn't get to the corner, cut back into the rest of those black and orange jerseys.
Rodriguez stacked up, fights hard, loses about a half yard. Dejon Terry and Omari Thomas clogged it up.
Yeah, right in the middle is where you're going to get the push. Good effort here, both on the inside. Just look at the strength and quickness there, winning your gap. They're slanting into the boundary, and that is a load in the inside with what Thomas can do and push. Along with Terry.
Now can Levis make a play on 3rd and 7?
His go-to man is Robinson, who's in the slot.
Look in that direction on a slant. Huge hit. Ball picked off. The Volunteers on the carom make an interception. Jawan Mitchell, they call him Juju, makes a huge play.
But what a hit on the outside right here that actually creates the ball where he pops up into the air. He doesn't hesitate at all. He drives down on that.
And he goes Slaughter.
Slaughter, who's a safety. Knocks that ball up into the air against the freshman Key. How about the heads-up play there by Mitchell, seeing that ball and almost takes it all the way back for another Vols touchdown.
Juju Mitchell there on the right, a 48-yard interception return to set up the Volunteers at the Kentucky 45, trying to build on this 14-point lead. Hooker, plenty of time, now runs out of time and is going to be sacked. Nobody home there. J.J. Weaver finally got him.
It's a great job with Mark Stoops and his defense. Coverage downfield, sitting in zone, no one-on-one matchups. Really good coverage. It allows that defensive line to eventually get that pressure to Hooker. Have not seen a lot of that. He's been decisive. Ball has been out of his hands quickly. It's been hard to get to him. But give coverage on the back end and assist before Weaver gets in.
Kentucky's first sack, an 8-yard loss. So that grinds the tempo right down. They become methodical way behind the sticks here. Hooker pressured again, escapes, and tries to create on the edge. He'll tuck it and run out of bounds about the 44. So he got about 9 of that back. Justin Rogers had the early pressure.
I thought Rogers was going to come up with another sack, but it gives you an idea. I mean, you look at Hooker and his build, 6'4", 218. You think he's slender and quick, and he is. But, man, he will surprise you with how powerful he is with his lower half and how he can pull out of some tackles.
That is the weapon that makes this offense even more dangerous. Spread you out, and then the quarterback is a tremendous athlete. Need 8 on third.
You say spread you out. For fans, this is not common, with the exception of about 3 or 4 offenses in the country.
Late pressure is picked up. Hooker gets the ball out, but he just bounced it. Threw it in the dirt about 4 yards short of Jalen Hyatt. It's fourth down.
I think Brad White, the defense coordinator from Kentucky, and Mark Stoops both telling us this week, listen, man, you can't hide from it. You're going to be out there one-on-one coverage, and you've got to hold up. And it helps when Hooker throws the ball low and doesn't throw it to Hyatt, who actually had a step there coming back to the football.
And Kirk, how crucial was the sack there and then that stop? They're down 14. Ball's at the 45 to begin the drive. They got 2 yards and 3 points.
It's the only 2 times we've seen them not score is when they've gotten behind the sticks with the sack. And earlier, it was the penalties that got them behind the sticks.
And that is a pretty well-executed pooch punt. Muffed the first time. The coverage team, but Jimmy Holiday down it, and Kentucky back way up.
Barry here, coming up in the Mercedes-Benz Halftime Report. Georgia got their cocktail against Florida. We'll show you highlights of that. Plus, Ohio State, they needed kind of a fourth quarter to run to separate from Penn State, and it was an absolute nightmare for Oklahoma State and Wake Forest in the top 10. We're going to talk some ball with Dan Mullen and Joey Galloway coming up at the half.
I'm mad all the folks around here are watching that Georgia-Florida game. And it was 28-3, and then it got to be a one-score game, yeah. The Gators, yeah. Where Georgia pulled away. So 2:49 for halftime. Cats do have all 3 timeouts. Got to be careful down here, to say the least, because Tennessee's been penetrating and hitting ball carriers right at the line. There's just not much daylight before contact. That was McLean knocked down by Flowers.
It'll be interesting to see just the strategy of this. All 3 timeouts, 2.5 minutes to go. Kentucky inside their own 2-yard line, shadow the goal line.
Heupel may choose to use the timeout
after
they get
play.
The stop here.
Yeah. Kentucky trying to work that clock. Remember, Hooker needs all, but what was it against Alabama? About 12 or 14 seconds, got in the field goal range. He doesn't need a lot of time. And movement on the right side.
Worked the play clock down, and the Wildcats lost patience.
False start. Offense number 79.
Deshaun Manning, the guard. It cost him about 1.5 feet. Ball back inside the 1 now.
And right guard comes out of his stance. Tough to hear. You could really see it any part of this stadium. I guess as the camera's looking, the other end would probably be the loudest where the students are. And if Kentucky fans, small patch of blue in front of them.
Let's see, they wind the clock after the penalty, so they can get this down inside of 1:30 before they snap it on the second down play. Stoops just trying to get to the dressing room. Just down 14. And breaking free is McLean, and they're going to get a first down. That changes the complexion big time.
There's some hard running right there, right? And we're used to seeing Rodriguez with this running. But I think McLean himself, he's surprised here. Right here, he looks, wait a second, I got a chance here. Great blocks. You think you saw a hole there? Maybe a little takedown?
Now,
remember, they have confidence in Will Levis. He's got some receivers that can win. See if they get aggressive or run.
Oh, dangerous throw, a long throw into traffic. Couple of guys had a chance there. Tamarian McDonald was in the vicinity.
Well, I thought that as soon as he let that go, I thought that McDonald had a chance. Looked like it may have gone right through his hands or over top of his hands. You see, oh boy, right through his hands. And
almost had another Karam interception there.
Slaughter, who made the big play earlier with a big hit that set up the interception by Mitchell. He kind of looked at him and said, if you wouldn't have tipped it, I had it too. Both those guys wanted the pick. Risky, dangerous throw by Will Levis.
You know about they run it this time?
They just get it to the edge, kind of a de facto running play, and Barry and Brown's
and he gets out of bounds.
Slaughter forced him out, so 50 seconds to go. Now it's third and six.
That's a true freshman. That's the risk you take on a simple throw to the flat, which is really just, again, kind of a throw, the extension of that run game. But the risk you take is you're putting a young freshman out there who instinctively tries to get to the edge, can't get there, and gets pushed out of bounds, and now you stop the clock. Man, Hooker does not need a lot of time.
Yeah, they get a stop here. No doubt Heupel will use the timeout, and they'll have enough to work with. And there's another pre-snap penalty.
And the right tackle.
False start.
False start. Offense number 77. 5 yard penalty.
One of the least noisiest spots, because the Wildcats are right in front of their own fans.
I don't think
it
matters if you're anywhere on this field.
Good point.
Anywhere on this field. It's tough for this offensive line, especially the guys on the edges. But the question, would they run or would they throw? At least on that attempt, they were going to throw the football. He's working to the trips to his right. Looked like he was going to get the ball to Tavion Robinson. Now they come out in a different formation.
Get Metallica cranked up here. This has become the Volunteers' success, one of the toughest places to play in college football again. Used to be in the 80s and 90s.
Give two more seconds. Put back up on a play clock. He was at 48. Back up to 50.
Again to the edge. Catch made. And fighting down there is Robinson. And now with 44 seconds to go. And fourth down, Tennessee can spend a timeout. So Hendon Hooker is going to have some time to work with, try to add to this 14-point lead, and they'll still have the two timeouts. Hey, we're staying in the SEC, head to Baton Rouge. Both the Tide and the Tigers, 5 weeks to rest up. We'll see you in primetime here on ESPN, presented by Subway. Battle for the SEC West?
Yeah, LSU has really turned things around since week one. When they lost and everybody started mocking Brian Kelly, what's he doing? He's got the accent. They can't win games. Well, he and Jaden Daniels have turned the corner. It's a confident football team. You get them back at home in Baton Rouge. You and I actually called that game a year ago, and it was supposed to be a blowout with Bryce Young and the Crimson Tide. It turned out to be a physical game and a close game. I expect more of the same when they meet up next Saturday night in Baton Rouge. It'll be a wild scene.
Tigers have bounced back since the Volunteers went to Death Valley and laid waste to them, blew them out. So Colin Goodfellow could use a good punt. Graduate student from Cleveland, St. Ignatius. Trying to back him up, D. Williams. And it looked like it was partially blocked. He had to hurry with the high snap. And it sails out of bounds at the Kentucky 42. They may spot it even closer. Like Caleb Perry, the linebacker, got in there.
Yeah, just a miscue up front. He's clean. I'm surprised he didn't block that. Nobody picked him up right up the middle. Miscommunication.
18-yard punt. I don't think he did get a piece of it, did he? He just a finger. But certainly Goodfellow was spooked by the pressure there.
Just what Hendon Hooker needs, a short field now at the 35-yard line, 37 seconds to go, and still has the two timeouts because Kentucky ran out of bounds.
As you said at the time, that the mental mistake by the freshman makes a big difference in this end-of-half sequence. Hooker checks it down to Small and has some space, and it's going to be tackled inbounds. So De'Eric Jackson makes the stop. Tennessee has a couple of timeouts, and they'll spend one here. And
Kentucky caught a break there, playing man to man with their on the receivers with the corners, and nobody stays with the back. Look at this man to man coverage, but the linebacker doesn't go to the outside with Small. He's good job of rallying to the ball. Pretty good job in the open field making up for that. But
mistake not getting out of bounds by Small. He tried to make a man miss and could have scooted to the sidelines to save the timeout. Beautiful evening here in Knoxville. Goodyear providing the aerial coverage, celebrating the challenge of road games everywhere. Are you ready for the road? Goodyear more driven.
Wouldn't be shocked at all. At this point, you stretch this defense out, get them again with your normal formations, create those vertical seams, and then try to take some shots, create matchups with pre-snap movement. 11, Hyatt, 4, Cedric Tillman. Both of them can win. They're both at the top, as for now, into the boundary.
They move Hyatt around, and not in the slot. He's about 2 yards from the Wildcat sideline.
Now they move him inside, trying to create matchups, favorable matchups.
Hooker looking instead to his left. Now moves back to the right. Launches. Wide open touchdown. Jalen Hyatt for the second time tonight. And the 14th time this season. They got that matchup and they got a confused defense again.
We just talked about they're going to create a matchup, right? We saw them do this so often. Josh Heupel talking there with Hendon Hooker. They are step for step in their communication. And Hooker is so dialed into this offense. But again, we knew that matchup was going to come. How many times against Alabama did we see that into the boundary?
Jalen Hyatt's having another night.
So they move. It's just a little thing like this. Watch the movement. We recognized it when they did this, right? So let's just switch here. I want you to keep an eye on the back end of this secondary. Watch the miscommunication. He's going to bump, and then watch this defensive back as well. Nobody goes with him down the sideline. So by going into the boundary, you work it all week. You try to give him every look you might have. Miscommunication by 14 and the safety to the inside, because you're not going to expect that big linebacker to run with Hyatt. You'd expect to have a safety over the top protecting him to save him. But again, Hyatt gets a lot of the credit, but give the scheme with Heupel and Golish a lot of credit as well for creating those matchups and a miscommunication with the Kentucky defense.
You know it's coming. You're right. They've drilled it all week. But the second time tonight, you had a linebacker in space trying to cover Jalen Hyatt, the safety not helping over the top.
Exactly. Safety's got to get over there, or the corner's got to sink. You don't want to leave that linebacker out there, and he was doing his job. He's sitting out in the flat, but nobody downfield.
Here's the pooch kick. Marianne Brown working around, trying to make something happen on the edge, and they're going to chase him down to the 15. So a couple of streaks here. 11 straight games for Hooker with multiple touchdown passes, and the Wildcat streak of holding opponents 24 or less every game since UT's last game. That snap, 10-27 in the first half. Holly?
Well, that connection between Hendon Hooker and Jalen Hyatt's been brewing since they were kids. They actually played AAU basketball together. They were both high-level basketball players and recruits, but both of their dads told them, if you want to stay in our house, you have to start playing football. That is a football family. These kids have been playing sports together for a long time, and that connection and chemistry is evident on the field between Hyatt and Hooker.
Yeah, Holly, Hooker was funny about that. His dad said, look, you can stop playing football. If you do, you're going to leave the house, but you can, it's your choice.
Your call.
So that's what you call an ultimatum. He just laughed. It's worked out well for him. Heisman candidate, Hendon Hooker. 12 of 14 for 148 and 2 touchdowns to Hyatt in the first half. Matt Berry and the guys, the Mercedes-Benz halftime report coming up. The lead is 21 for the Volunteers. On Rocky Top, no look ahead, just looking real good for Tennessee. Welcome back to ESPN College Football Primetime, presented by Subway, in this presentation of the SEC on ESPN. 21-point margin at halftime for Tennessee. The late touchdown, 2 touchdown passes from Hendon Hooker to Jalen Hyatt, who has now set a new Tennessee record for touchdown receptions in a season. And he's got, 4 more regular season games to go after this.
In a second half.
Chris Fowler, Kirk Herbstreit, back with you. We knew it was going to be a matchup of frantic, fast tempo against the grinding Kentucky offense, but Tennessee's done it actually both ways, and the defense made a huge play, that pick down there in the red zone.
Well, it continues, I think, to be one of the toughest offenses for any defense to match up with. Mark Stoops, keep in mind, had a bye week. And he's one of the better defensive minds you'll see in the country. Him and his staff came up with a plan, and I wonder if at times when you watch them, if they put maybe a little bit too much in with that bye week, because there's been some miscommunication on the back end. A lot of this, when you're dealing with tempo, is just getting the call in and getting yourself lined up and being ready. We saw a number of times just Mark and his defense just trying to deal with it. Hey, and it's nothing Mark's not really doing. It's just how tough it is for everybody, Nick Saban included, anybody that they have faced, to try to match up with him and get lined up.
Mark Stoops, his older brother Mike, is on the staff. Brad White, a very highly regarded defensive mind, is the coordinator. But that group together, not been able to solve the puzzle, Volunteers, and really no one has so far in this 22 season. Kentucky gets the football first, and we'll see if Will Levis can create something to cut into this margin. They're not really built for this. Here's the Modelo fighting spirit moment.
Yeah, it's if you miss the first half, it's been what Tennessee does with Josh Heupel. It's tempo, Hooker, who has a great feel for this offense. Great job of finding opportunities when you bust a coverage. Just like this early, that was their first touchdown, and then throughout the entire first half, this is the other bust coverage. He had a corner, jumped to the inside. Nobody in the back end. And Hyatt again. Formation into the boundary. And a bust.
Go back a quarter century, Kirk. Hyatt is now the second player in the SEC to catch 11 touchdowns over a four-game span. A guy named Devontae Smith in his Heisman season.
Yeah.
That's how good Hyatt and this Hooker combination. Holly talked about the chemistry. Meanwhile, Kentucky to work here. Little shovel pass inside. They give it off to Jordan Dingle, who's knocked down after a couple yards. There's Hyatt.
And I think one of the things that happens to anybody, and I think we're seeing it with Kentucky tonight, they are a ground and pound and play action team. And you get down by 14, you get down by 20, and you get down by 21, and all of a sudden you start to think, do we stick with our plan? You got to avoid panicking, at least in the first half. But at some point, you want to be able to try to attack and open things up. And remember, this secondary from Tennessee has struggled against a lot of teams they have played.
Now the game is to be methodical, use a lot of the play clock, but you're going to limit yourself. Immediate pressure. Levis backpedaling. He'll be sacked at the 15. Dejon Terry's had a monster game. He got a hand on the PAT, and he's been in the backfield consistently tonight.
He really has. He and Amari Thomas are just big and physical and a lot. See, the center moves to the right. The left guard, Burton, what a tough block. Watch 62. All that momentum and size of Terry, he gets right by him. And Levis tried to hold on as long as he could, but with interior pressure, man, it's a quarterback's worst nightmare.
It's a big man running quickly, arms reach out, got to the quarterback that transferred from Kansas. Big trouble here on third and 17. Levis pressured again and sacked. Slammed down at the 7 by Byron Young, the top pass rusher on this defense. And Tyler Barron joined him in the backfield.
Well, Tim Banks dialing up some of his own pressure without necessarily having to bring extra bodies. This is best pass rusher, Young. Little outside-inside twist, and they actually both get home. Flax, the right tackle, is beaten as well by Barron. And keep in mind, this offensive line, when Flax coming back, was supposed to help solidify them, but it's been an issue all year protecting the quarterback in protection.
Once again, Kentucky punts backed up. This is a better effort than the 18-yarder. At the end of the half, D. Williams makes a couple guys miss. Still running, look out, bumping into his own man. Eventually knocked down at the 41. But again, Hooker will have a short field to deal with. Holly?
Well, guys, you're talking about the communication issues on defense for Kentucky, and there's a very good reason. Their three-time captain, DeAndre Square, was out for that drive and will not return to this game with a right ankle injury. It's a huge deal because he gets everybody lined up, communicates the whole defense. So that will fall to De'Eric who is right next to him, a junior, Derek Jackson, who will take over that role for communicating. Also keep your eye on the strong safety, Tyrell Asian. He was out for that drive as well with a back injury, but they expect he'll be able to return right now.
Kentucky's defensive problems mount as they try to, again, stop the Volunteers and begin in plus territory. Jabari Small wrestled down. A little story of Byron Young, who got involved in that sack. Here's a guy that was working at a Dollar General, right? He's out of football. He's in the workforce. He sees a flyer and goes, you know what? Georgia military. Let me give that a try. He goes from there to Tennessee, playing in front of 100,000 people. And he's the top pass rusher on this defense. Brew McCoy, you hear the crowd staring at him, makes the catch. It's big number six.
What a story that is. And
He's a raw guy. He's still going to get drafted and be able to arrive in the NFL with still plenty to work on.
Yeah.
Worked hard. He's the biggest physical transformation on this team.
Yeah, and you know, so much attention gets put onto the offense. It's nice for this defense, especially in this opening drive in the second half, to turn up that pass rush.
Tennessee, when they've had those third downs, has so often been third and short, and Small leans for another first down.
They love that formation when they put that tight end, Jacob Warren, instead of out on the edge. They just put him right behind the guard and the tackle. Oh, boy.
Chaos. The ball is snapped. Tennessee's got guys all over the field. There's a flag down. A couple of them in the secondary and one back at the line of scrimmage. And Stoops going crazy saying they weren't given a chance to get the subs on the field. They tried to bring about four different guys in.
Well, that's what he's saying. If they have a substitution, then we should have a chance. And
legal substitution, defense, 12 players on the field to play when the ball is leaving the snap. 5-yard penalty.
The thing is, Brew McCoy looked like he was limping off the field, but he never went off the field. So you see him at the bottom. They're Tennessee didn't substitute anybody.
Heupel, you can see waving his arms saying,
yeah,
go, go.
Got him. And I think there's Mark, I think, thought that McCoy, who was limping, was going off the field, which signified to him, hey, we got time to try to get players on, but nobody had left the field.
The relentless pressure and stress that the Tennessee offense puts on a defense in numerous ways, showing up again tonight. Hooker across the middle, airmail, way over the head of McCoy that time. Talk about an offense, Kirk, that is scoring about 2 points for every minute of possession. I've never seen that stat. I just started noticing that they get 51 points a game, 52 points a game for about 26 minutes of possession. That's crazy, crazy stuff. That's like basketball stat.
It is. I mean, it is. And again, we just, you don't see the, and there's Golish, the offensive coordinator. He calls the plays. Obviously, Josh Heupel heavily involved as well.
Interesting conversation with him. Talk about how his mind has to work so quickly. They want to figure out where the ball is going to end up on the previous play. Call the next play ahead.
And I talked to Lane Kiffin because he had Jeff Lebby there last year from the same coaching tree. And he marvels at how quickly these guys call these plays.
And if somebody, you know, needs a rest, taps their helmet, goes out, he has to decide, do we sub him out or do we just call a play away from him, don't involve him to keep that tempo going? It's amazing the stuff that these play callers and the high tempo offenses have to juggle.
Oh, yeah. Well, you have to think about an either or kind of situation. And as soon as your ball carrier or receiver is tackled, you got to make the call.
So Khalil Saunders, who's the defensive lineman, down for the Wildcats. Tonight's player spotlight brought to you by Royal Caribbean. And it's hard to top that kind of efficiency for Hendon Hooker. Both those touchdowns are to Hyatt. Haven't really needed to flash his running ability, some small, like strategic runs, but it's been operating from the pocket.
I mean, the coaches get so much attention for the scheme, but Hooker, to me, his knowledge of the offense, how much time he's graduated, so he's over at the football office all day working with the coaches, kind of like we used to hear about Joe Burrow when he graduated. He was at LSU in 2019, always over there with Joe Brady, to the point where you know the offense and the plan like a coach. You're like a GA, but you're playing quarterback. And he is so decisive and has an answer for anything that you go to. And it's like, you know, you see with Bryce Young, CJ Stroud, a lot of the top quarterbacks, they have answers. in this scheme, as fast as it goes, it's hard to be efficient when you go that fast. And I think that's the thing that I've really stepped back and appreciated the most about Hendon Hooker, is how efficient he has been with Heupel and Golish in this offense. Good to see the big fella Saunders up and walking off.
Yeah, and his understanding in year two just jump way forward. Yeah. Holly?
Talked with Hendon Hooker's dad before the game. You know, he got beat out twice at Virginia Tech, and then when he got here, he got beat out by Joe Milton. And instead of blaming the coaches and thinking everybody else was wrong, this young man got to work and got better. He started calling around, how can I improve my motion? How can I improve what I'm seeing on the field? And Hendon Hooker is a great lesson to others, is when you get beat out, keep working. And he told the coaches that day they had the conversation that he got beat out, well, don't count me out. I'm still coming for this job, and here he is.
It's very rare to hear that anymore, right, Holly? And that's pretty incredible.
He and Joe Milton are roommates. They've stayed close friends despite that competition.
So often guys lose a job, they transfer. And not this guy.
Small plows forward. You know, Hooker was plus 6,000. Now our guy Bear knows what that means. That means ultra, ultra, ultra Heisman long shot before this season. After the Alabama win, he jumped up. He's got the second shortest odds after C.J. Stroud, who today had some moments in Ohio State's win over Penn State. And Hooker continues to do this. He'll have a showcase game at Georgia next week.
Oh, yeah, that'd be can you imagine the hype for that? Everybody's been waiting for that matchup for weeks, especially after what they did against Alabama. Get that clap. You see the blitz to his right. Looks over, gets the adjustment. See if Kentucky falls out of the pressure that they were showing right here. They're looking over too. See if they kill it or bring it. They're still bringing it.
Small darts around. The middle was clawed. No gain. And we'll see if Heupel actually sends out the field goal team. Justin Rogers did his job from the nose tackle position. And yeah, they'll send out McGrath. Anytime that Rocky Top's not playing after a touchdown in your defense in 2022, you feel like that's a win.
That is a win.
McGrath has been rock solid inside of 47-47 this year. Thrown 29 yards out. It's perfect. Volunteers add to the lead, which is 24 midway in the third quarter. Well, tomorrow morning from London on ESPN Plus exclusively, Broncos and the Jaguars, 9:30 a.m. Eastern time. I hope shifting Kirk to the other side of the pond will somehow ignite Denver's offense, or the folks over there will. We'll see more field goals. They should.
The good news is Trevor Lawrence and Jacksonville playing better this year.
Two teams starving for a win, though. CFP National Championship Trophy presented by Dr. Pepper. SoFi Stadium is the scene of the championship game. Semifinals in Atlanta and Glendale on New Year's Eve.
Playoff rankings come out Tuesday. First.
You guys will have the exclusive reveal there.
Yeah.
Where will Tennessee sit? Tom McClain knocked out. We know the Volunteers will head for Athens, Georgia for that showdown next Saturday. And not just Georgia, but all the folks in college football who loved and respected Vince Dooley, mourning the passing of the legend at 90. That was him getting taken off the field after winning the championship in 80, and then on the field Indianapolis as the confetti fell and the Dogs won their first championship since his year with Herschel Walker. Vince, 90 years old.
One of the great gentlemen of the sport of all time. Boy, David Pollack reflected back this morning on College Game Day, his relationship with Coach Dooley. Tell how special it was. I'm sure it's that way for all the former Dogs.
Rodriguez tracked down, 26 years as a Georgia head coach, quarter century as athletic director too. So besides these achievements in football were significant, the overall Georgia athletic program under his stewardship was outstanding. It was the way that he did it.
So yeah, I think that's
so dignified.
Yep.
Right? So classy.
Absolutely.
Quiet toughness his teams played with.
Yeah. The condolences to the Dooley family and all the Georgia Bulldog Nation. We saw Derek last week when we were in Tuscaloosa. Our thoughts are with him and his entire family.
Rodriguez has to run through a tackle in the backfield. He escaped. Garrett Garland got about three, and it's third and long again, Kirk.
Tell you what, man, I know we're here to watch Hendon Hooker in this offense. You know what I'm excited about? Watching Stetson Bennett next week against his Vols defense. They are getting off blocks. You know, they're becoming that defense that nobody talks about. And you look at the stats, and if they're this and they're that. But they have some athletes up front, some size.
Some depth, man. They rotate dudes in.
Man, they've got something to them, and they're only going to get better.
It's been a nightmare for Kentucky on third down. Stoops says we have to be great on third, anything but. And that one is picked off, threw it right into traffic. And Brandon Turnage with a second takeaway for this Tennessee defense. Pressing on third down again. Tough decision.
Yeah, he tried to squeeze one into tight coverage. Never really had a chance. His receiver is a young guy who kind of comes in here and settles. You got a corner here, you got a linebacker here. And the ball comes out a little bit late. See the route right here. That corner is in great position. Great position with his eyes on the ball that allows him to break on the ball, but that's just a forced throw to the freshman Key. The secondary, for the most part tonight, they've accepted this challenge against Levis. They've been in coverage where they can be able to break on the ball with their eyes on the ball. They've mixed in some man, but doing a good job in zone.
Turnage, a guy that ran into a wall, a scary moment last week's game. Okay to return this week, and right back to Jalen Hyatt, who's trying to get a hat trick tonight. Chris Slaughter, who made one of the biggest plays of the night, jarred the ball loose in the slant.
Yeah, I mean,
set up the interception.
It was 20-6, and Kentucky was going in. There's Hyatt over, going over to the sideline. Obviously,
down on one knee.
Yeah, let's see how he's doing. Monster year. You could argue, I don't know if there's any receiver at this point, as far as stats are concerned, that have put up numbers like he has in this offense.
Now he's been the premier big play threat in college football. A hush over this crowd as they look at him. Squirrel White to bring in to replace him, and they find Brew McCoy on this pass for first down yardage.
Yep. Well, there's a swing there, and see if they end up calling a, no, they're not going to call a flag. Here's the injury. He's just trying to fight for extra yards there, and got up and everything looked fine, and he worked himself over to the sideline.
With the play action, throw to the end zone. Squirrel White, true freshman, filling in for Hyatt, made a play on it, and Drew Phillips was in coverage.
I know they didn't complete this, but I love where he put this football in the slot fade. Just put it out over the outside shoulder. You got a lot of space to work with when you throw that pass from the slot. And he took advantage of it, put him out away from that defensive back. Hyde is up, moving around. Phillips was out there isolated there, and boy, because of how well that ball was thrown, I thought he might come down with it.
So Hyatt is going to be able to return. Octavius Oxendine wrestling down Small right at the line of scrimmage. There's old Smokey. We had Bully from Mississippi State up in the booth last week. We thought, hey, Smokey's turn. I guess you guys at game day, you got them too riled up as they're playing quickly. The ball's batted away in the end zone. White again, the intended receiver, and Phillips broke that up. He said, no, Smokey got a little too excited when you guys were here, and he will not be visiting the booth.
Meanwhile, I still got a lower back problem from last week.
No, you don't.
D-Mob asked me to pick that bully up twice. Smokey would have been a little bit easier to get up.
That's Smokey 10. Smokey 11 got an introduction to the crowd here. The Smokey 11 will be the heir apparent. He's a young guy. They have to take Smokey to practice and let him get used to this noise from the speakers. That's what they do. Like when Tennessee's playing on the road, they'd bring him to practice, get him used to all this. It's a lot for
it is for
a dog.
Yeah, Corso had him up on the set when we were here a few weeks ago for the Alabama game. He wasn't feeling all that energy.
McGrath doinks it off the left upright from 37. And still a 24-point margin.
ESPN College Football Primetime, presented by Subway, is brought to you by Pepsi, made for football watching.
Saw Al Wilson on the field before the game, part of that 98 championship defense with Philip Fulmer there.
Man, I saw
that's it, though. That's the last time they won the SEC and the national championship. Yeah. There's the Taco Bell Livmas Student Section of the Year contest. First time since 06, they've sold it out five in a row, and don't figure to be many empty seats from here on out at Neyland Stadium. People are loving the ride this team is on.
That 98 team with T. Martin. This is my third year being around this craziness of the SEC, and they make it all the way to the championship and win it.
Florida State and Arizona play action. Levis ready to launch downfield. He throws it across the middle. In the end, there's very good coverage there by Trayvon Flowers against Jordan Dingle.
Really good play by Flowers here. Top of the route, he ends up just following him. Watch how he follows across. Shows you some of the athletic ability he has. It's a big tight end. What I love is he's got the speed. And again, he's able to time that left arm and hand in there to keep that ball away from Dingle from making that catch. Gave him that cushion, knew that he's coming out, and then on the crosser, just uses his athletic ability to stay with him.
Levis on second and 10. Takes a shot downfield, jump ball, and it's picked off again. Danico Slaughter, whose carom set up the first pick tonight, now has one of his own, and that's the hat trick for Levis. This is a tough, tough night for Kentucky's elite quarterback.
But you're left on an island. You're playing man free. You've got to win. They're going up against freshmen. They're confident that they can stay with them. And Slaughter, who's made every play he's been asked, that ball just feels like it's a little late. Looked like Key had a couple steps on him. But in man free, Slaughter be able to read the eyes of Key, gets his own body turned, locates the ball, and then again, the athletic ability to make the play.
So the quarters have been its problem all year. You know, Warren Burrell, season-ending injury against Pitt. You got Christian Charles out tonight. Kamal Haddon out tonight. First start at corner for a guy who's really a safety. And Slaughter has set up one pick and made another and played in good coverage. That's about as good as you can do in your corner debut, man.
And again, I think this secondary has a bit of a chip on their shoulder. You know, they hear a lot about how they're 130th. 130th in the country in pass defense. Only 131 teams. They're going to review this to see to make sure he secured this catch. You could see Will Levis, he really wants this looked at. Like, he's confident. He wants the whole offense to come down. He thinks they're going to go back out on the field.
See if he controlled the ball to the ground, turned the body.
What an effort.
He squirts out right there, but I don't think it ever hit the ground. It looks like Slaughter maintained control of it.
Yeah, the ball did come out, but it never touched the ground after it came out. We're going to have a catch here.
Yeah, he had to finish the job because right here, instead of letting it hit the ground, he cradles it.
All right, here's a great look for you, Bill. What do you say here? No? See that? You okay with the little movement there with the ball?
The ball moved, but at the same time,
still has it secured.
Does it ever hit the ground? It hits his arm there.
Just can't. Yeah.
That way looks tough to say. His body's blocking our view. We had a good look earlier though, and I thought that he did hold on to it.
Can't imagine then turning that around.
I could read his lips. He said catch.
after further review, ruling on the field stands. First down.
So Levis does throw a third pick. You know, we talked about the third down importance for this Kentucky team, and yeah, it's been a nightmare. They're 1 of 8. He's thrown two picks on third down. That was on second and long, but just have not been able to come through. The average yards to make on third down tonight, 9. That's not going to work.
No, and that was what they wanted to avoid against this defense. By the way, I think he's frustrated. I mean, obviously he's frustrated. I think he's frustrated with the call because his entire offense almost to the hash mark. They thought they were going to get that overturned and be back out on the field.
Jalin Hyatt back on the field for Tennessee. Fans can breathe a sigh of relief. He's in his usual spot in the slot. Hooker looking that way, delivers across the middle. It's McCoy who makes a catch. Boy, he's just a tough guy to tackle. He gets yards after the catch, not because he's that fast, but he's just hard to get down.
Yeah, well, he just went right over, ran over top of Childress, the safety, to prove your point.
You sling it this side. And again, McCoy.
Getting him more involved, you know, with Tillman back. This offense has been executing without Tillman. Now you have McCoy, Tillman, and of course Hyatt. All three of these guys can win one-on-one in different ways.
Good to see Tillman back. He was the question. How many snaps could he go? They got him very involved early. Tillman with those 4 catches. McCoy, 6 receptions tonight. And Hyatt doing his thing with 4-2 for touchdowns. Right. Stutter step. Still going. Second time tonight. Looks like he's going to go to the ground, but he refuses to. Spins for more yards.
What a great job on the left side. Carvin to left guard. Crawford to left tackle. Little twist game up front. Good communication. Opens up nicely.
At that time slung down. We talked about the 1-2 punch. Jabari Small, guy is very tough. 8 rushing touchdowns coming in right. Not as good a receiver. Not, you don't think as physical, but man, he has proven a point tonight.
Yeah, sure is.
Option look. Hooker fakes the pitch, spins, and scores. Season-long party continues on Rocky Top. Are you watching in Athens, Georgia? Kirby Smart, are you looking in tonight?
Oh, yeah.
Nation.
Oh, yeah.
It's on for next weekend between the hedges.
And that's the X factor in preparing a defensive plan is they throw it 5 to 7 to 8 times. Quarterback option, quarterback draw. You have to account for it because he's such a good runner. Look at this.
Sorry, Kirk.
Yeah, I was going to say speed option. And this is great execution. The left tackle actually gets up. This is, puts this defense in no man's land because he's attacking you with speed. He can either deal it or fake it, get underneath. Look at the left tackle, 53, gets to that second level, and he is a physical runner.
All 8 games now, 34 plus. I think the blimp can hear the party. What's going on in this place tonight? Good year. Providing your aero coverage as always, road tested and game ready. Are you ready for the road? Goodyear, more driven. Volunteers hit the road. We'll talk more about that looming showdown with Georgia because this has been yet another emphatic statement by the defense as well as the offense. Curtis Wilson on the All-State bus cruising around Knoxville this week. Kirk, what's your All-State mayhem moment today?
It's Ohio State against Penn State. You know, Penn State had command of this game, and then Trevion Henderson in the fourth quarter, under 9 minutes to go, turned the complexion of this game around. Ohio State tested in every way, but this was a big day for Ohio State. A complete effort, offense, defense. They needed that test. They answered the bell. I think Ohio State gets stronger after a game like that, where Penn State gave everything.
Oh my goodness, what a monster game!
Oh yeah, he was everywhere.
He was. Levis living a nightmare is one of the worst games of his excellent college career. His last 8 passes, Kirk, 3 for 8 with 3 picks and 6 yards. Part of this 30-zip Tennessee run.
The Tennessee defense has really stepped up tonight. I'm sure they heard all week. Hey, you know, hey, guys, we've given up a ton of yards through the air this year. We're going up against Will Levis. I know they want to run the ball, but don't be shocked if they try to attack us downfield with these young receivers. And the secondary heard that. They've come up with these turnovers, have had their eyes a lot of times on Will Levis to know when to break on the ball and come up with these plays.
137 total yards for the Cats. That's it. Brown has a little crease, gets a block on the edge, and is wrestled down near the marker at the 35 by McCullough. It'll be a first down.
Yeah, just a little pressure from the outside. Recognized, ball out quickly to the slot. They think this Berrian Brown, young man out of Nashville, he went to Pearl Cone High School there, produces a lot of great players, but he's got great quickness after the catch.
22 miles per hour on the catapult, so he's got world-class speed, big future.
Yep.
Here comes the blitz. They get it to McLean in the flat, but ready to lay the lumber there was Wesley Walker.
Get blitz here. He walks and then he blitzes. What I love is the recognition that this ball is going to have to come out fast. Watch how quickly he's able to diagnose that. Nobody accounts for him, and Walker comes in and makes that play. Transferred out of Georgia Tech.
Willie Martinez.
Pretty fired up.
Been around forever.
That's why he drew it up all week.
Behind the six yet again. Second and 15. They get it to the edge to Tom Robinson. And he's going to get back across the original line of scrimmage. Matt?
Yeah, Chris, back and forth. Ole Miss, Texas A&M. Want to get you updated on that one here. Jackson Dart to Casey Kelly. Nice rollout. Back to the end zone. Ole Miss retakes the lead 17-14. And perhaps surprisingly, Arizona hanging with USC. Jaden DeLoria here to Dorian Singer. That just a one-score game now, 31-23.
It's Chris Lewis, one of the wide receivers for Kentucky, being tended to by the athletic trainers. Well, we talked about this collision in Tennessee proving their point. They were not looking past Kentucky. A strong performance tonight. You saw the Georgia-Florida game.
Yeah.
Dogs were throwing haymakers early, but Florida had some traction. Give me the early lean and take on that game.
I just think what you just said about Tennessee is very important because this is new territory for them, not necessarily the program, but for this team over the last several years, and the maturity to be able to deal with all the pats on the back and keep their razor edge. I think this team has done a great job. Alabama celebration, Georgia next week, and here's little old Kentucky that looks like a potential threat because their style of play, and they just knock them out. I think it shows that this engine just keeps getting stronger and stronger and stronger. And then there's Georgia, the defending champs, that truthfully I feel like they've been on the back burner, a team that no one's really talked about since the Oregon game. They get front and center next week in Athens with Hendon Hooker in this offense going up against that Georgia defense. Everybody's been waiting for this one.
Yeah, Tennessee's been dominated by Georgia head-to-head. The games really haven't been close. I think it's six in a row. I think maybe 23 is the closest in that span of time. And I think that Heupel preached it. Game by game, don't look ahead. But it really comes
hard.
From players.
Yeah.
Hendon Hooker,
I
was so impressed with him yesterday. Hyatt, Young, the three leaders of that team were in that room. All of them said, we're tuning that out. We're not listening to the hype that's building around this place. Hey, you're in the playoffs.
Well, they've suffered for so long, right? I mean, the guys that are older that have been around here for 3, 4, or 5 years, they've been through so – people forget. I mean, this program was once in Alabama in the SEC. They set the tone. They were the measuring stick. And it's been a long time since they have been that. That's why this fan base, you and I are talking at every break. Look at these fans. I mean, they are starving. Their players are starving. These fans are starving. That's why it's all on the line. No subjectivity. We get to see it on the field for 60 next week.
Third and eight. They bring pressure again. It's picked up this time. Levis backpedaling, checks it down underneath. And that's not going to be a first down. Jaton McLean made the catch. It's fourth down and about four. Figure they keep the offense on the field.
He just slipped out of the backfield. His pressure is battle with the line of scrimmage. Tennessee is winning, especially when it comes to getting pressure. Remember, that's been a trouble spot for Kentucky coming into tonight. They allowed 26 sacks. And you get into obvious passing situations, man, it's a disaster for Levis in this line.
It has been. Levis gets it out, catch made, and they do move the six as a flag down.
The referee reached into his back pocket because Levis got hit low right when he started to throw the ball. Watch the referee in the background. He reaches, he's about, well, you can't see him. He was about to actually throw it. I thought he might.
Not supposed to be able to hit the quarterback down below the knees there. Intentionally, anyway. Robinson, nothing. Wrestled down again by Wesley Walker, who plays that star position, and he has starred tonight.
So he gets hit low. So a lot of times that catches the attention. Watch the referee. He reaches. Bill, what's that? What is that?
Well, if you go in with the helmet or the shoulder, you do have a foul.
Yeah.
But if you go in wrap up, no.
Then why do you reach in that pocket?
He second guessed himself.
Cross exam. Isn't it true? Mr. LaMagne. Fourth quarter coming up, ESPN College Football Primetime. Welcome back to this presentation of the SEC on ESPN. It has been electric from the run out here on Blackout Night in Knoxville. Volunteers scored in their third play. Kentucky would answer, but after that, it has been all Tennessee. 30 consecutive points, three takeaways. By that defense, all interceptions of Will Levis. Yes, it just feels like they've been fighting like uphill, a steep climb all night. And there's another mistake. The offensive focus hasn't been there.
77, 5-yard penalty, remains second down.
Tackle Jeremy Flax backed out. They haven't executed well, and they've been so ineffective on first and second down. It's been third and long a lot for Stoops' offense. And in that position, the pass rush has gotten to Levis, and he's pressed a bit.
That's
Volunteers have been opportunistic.
Yeah, and again, when you get down to this offense, and you're on the road in this atmosphere, pretty easy to press.
Second and 18, Levis pressured again. Guys hanging all over him. And he bounces the throw. Line of scrimmage has been a mismatch tonight.
Really has. And watch this little move to the right of that offensive line affects the communication. And even though you don't come up with a sack, you're able to affect the quarterback and get him jittery and uncomfortable and hang on to his foot, make him get rid of that ball.
A true freshman, Tyree West. We talked about the depth. They just roll guys in. These guys coming after Levis, they're fresh. There's a throw in the sidelines, incomplete, over the outstretched hands of McLean. It came out of the backfield. And the Wildcats will have to punt it away again. Jeremy Banks was there again.
And it's a good job of contesting everything. You know, like even this throw here, trying to get it to the out of the backfield to McLean, who's there being looked at by a trainer. But even just come out of the backfield, you've got tight coverage there by Banks, making it tough between that and the pass rush to flush Levis out of the pocket. You could argue this is the best effort that the Vols defense has put forth this year as they get ready for the major showdown.
I totally agree with
Georgia.
That.
Yeah.
So my defense has given up two 400-yard passing games. Richardson and Bryce Young lit them up. Two other 300-yard passing games tonight. Levis has thrown for 90. So we get the playoff rankings release on Tuesday. The CFP Top 25 show presented by Allstate. We'll break it down from top to bottom. You don't have to wait till Tuesday because Mr. Herbstreit's already giving you his top four. This is very this is real time here. Tennessee up to
I just moved them up to one only because you have to look at who they've played, and teams that have been ranked gives him the edge. I had a slight change. They won at LSU. They beat Alabama consecutive weeks. what they're doing tonight against Kentucky. You have to recognize that. So I would put them there. They played Georgia, who I have at three. That'll work itself out.
I got to read something here. Hold on.
Yep.
Go to ESPN.com/Allstate Playoff Predictor. Check out your team's chance to make the CFP. As you were saying.
No, I'm good, okay, man.
Good.
I think you should do your
all right.
Top four, too, for fun.
Like, what do you have? Spot?
Yeah, what do you what
give me a play to think about. Most of the precincts are reporting. You're putting Tennessee through comfortably by this
not game. Comfortably at all. I
but in this game.
Yeah, that sums it up right there.
No, the road team This is a little personal for a lot of the fans. It's a little personal between at least Josh Heupel and the Stoops family. You recall, of course, he was very connected to Bob. Went to Oklahoma, won a national championship. Bob Stoops' only national championship quarterback. Then got fired
yep.
as co-offensive coordinator.
Good stuff. But who's your top four?
I'll get back to it.
You're going to finish this?
I just want to finish this little story here because, he hung out with Mark Stoops. He lived in Mark Stoops' house when they worked for Mike Stoops back in Arizona.
That's right.
But then the way things ended in Oklahoma, you get fired by your alma mater. It worked out awesome for Heupel, by the way.
Yeah.
And he said that yesterday. He says he's okay with them, but he is enjoying tonight's margin.
Yeah, I'll let you buy a little bit more time. I asked Billy to pull this up. I think Josh Heupel seeing the game from a quarterback's perspective. This goes back to his OU days when they got on a run with Bob Stoops and the lefty was winning games early in the year that they weren't expected to win. They got confident, ended up winning it all.
Short run for Small. By the way, when he was fired after an 8-win season, Lincoln Riley was the hire for Bob Stoops. It also worked out pretty good for Stoops and for Riley and now for Heupel.
It's all worked
no
out.
No losers as it worked out.
I saw Torrence Marshall on the field for the game. And, of course, when I think of Heupel and Marshall, I think of the coin flip in the national championship that year in the Orange Bowl with Wanky and Florida State. He walked out there, didn't shake his hand. He just said, I'm coming to get my man's trophy tonight because Heupel didn't win the Heisman and Oklahoma shut them down.
They basically shut out the offense. So
they did.
Late safety. Hyatt is loose again and there goes that man down to the 25. Another huge play from the guy who leads college football in long receptions this year.
Yeah, another miscommunication down that right sideline. Same, there's been three now where the safety in the corner just not on the same page.
Who are they playing next week? Georgia. Yeah. Kirby Smart, offensive brain trust of Saban. You think they have a lot to look at, but I mean, I spent a good part of the week. What is number 11 going to do?
How
do
we defend? My man, but in defense of these defensive masterminds, Mark Stoops, Pete Golding, Nick Saban, you know, they know if it's the tempo that goes with it that I think affects the communication on the back end. It's not just the it's not just the design of the wheel route of Hyatt going. It's more of just how they get it going. He didn't want him to get the Tennessee Vol chant going while they're on offense. But you throw in all the different looks, your eyes can easily get confused.
No doubt. And we've seen it again and again and again.
It'll be interesting to see if Kirby can figure that out.
I'm not attacking Pete Golding or Saban or the the challenge is there. So number 11 is a serious problem for anybody who plays them, and we'll see if Georgia can have some answers.
I tell you, man, what Heupel and Golish are doing is they move him around, and then with the tempo, and that forces even extra communication.
That's Caton. Snap there, and couldn't quite hold on to it. Holly.
Well, Jalen Hyatt had that great game against Alabama, 5 touchdowns. T-shirts were being made with his face on it. He said he does not have one and he won't wear it. But the thing that's really cool about him is he didn't get all hyped up after that moment. He went to work. On Tuesdays and Wednesdays, he came right in and is catching 1,000 balls off the jugs machine. He said, I didn't want Alabama to be my last big moment. I want it to be the beginning of something special.
That was well said, wasn't it, Holly? By the way, Hooker said he'd buy one of those shirts with Hyatt's face on it. He had no problem wearing one around. Jalen said his parents did come up with them.
So they just moved Hyatt again.
3rd and 12, and Hooker's going to be slung down for the second time tonight. is Trayvon Ribka.
Crowd reacting for him throwing down Hooker. Good slant, little slant and angle by Ribka. Able to get him through a gap and get into the backfield pretty quickly.
If they make fourth and 20 here, Kirk, you just got to.
So you're just going to you're just going to wuss out here. You're not going to do your four. I just want you to be able to hear.
Did you say wuss out?
Yeah, I want you to be able to hear.
What are you so excited about?
I just want you to say
who the top four. No, I'm not. It's going to be, I would put either Tennessee or Ohio State.
I would give a slight
edge to Tennessee.
Okay.
They've beaten five ranked teams.
Got it.
The eye test is super close. Ohio State's defense stepped up big today, but Penn State battled them. Tennessee's blasting people.
Three is what?
Lately.
Three is.
Man, stuff. After this commercial break, okay. Give me the top two.
It'll be breaking news. People want to hear it.
ESPN College Football Primetime is presented by Subway. Try the all-new Subway Series menu. Your pick of 12 irresistible subs.
Even the flyover was beautifully executed tonight. Loud and exciting F-35s.
Rattled the
stadium. It's been a party ever since then. Here's Goodyear's College Football rankings. It's the AP poll. Of course, the CFP committee rankings will take over next week.
Chris, what do you have against TCU? You don't talk about them much.
I have a deep and abiding hatred for TCU's program. You know that, Kirk. Darn you for exposing it right here. National TV. We're going to get to see the Horned Frogs, I predict.
It's a
challenge for them on the road.
And in Austin. Be really good.
Nothing wrong. Can't do better than they have. Sonny Dykes, what a year one, TCU. So they're very much in contention. They're going to need a little help in that they can't be the fifth undefeated team. But they're going to have teams ahead of them begin to collide, obviously starting next week. And Ohio State and Michigan, answer your question. I guess I didn't look at yours, but I think Georgia's third best.
Yeah.
Michigan didn't play anybody non-conference, certainly looking very solid, getting a battle tonight from Sparty, but they're going to win, it looks like, in the Big House. So I put them four, but not a strong four over. Yeah. You know, Alabama comes in here, loses on a missed field goal, basically. Clemson has had its struggles. I put TCU, right there. We got the same teams. Let me say this. I don't put a high level of importance on the rankings in early November.
No, I don't think.
It's a long way to go. And
just fodder. Just fun discussion.
What I think everybody else thinks is.
Yeah.
You know.
Well, the good thing is about Tennessee and Georgia, we're going to find out next week.
What's interesting is that game is actually potentially more important for Tennessee's chances of winning the East, because they can't lose the game. Georgia's not going to lose twice, than it is for the playoff.
Right, right,
right.
You're going to Matt Berry and Joseph Scott Galloway, I think, is with him, but I think Matty's the only one that's going to be checking in with us.
Yeah, I'm going to get you updated here, Herb, on USC and Arizona. Caleb Williams, 5 touchdown passes on the night, 38-29. Trojans up. Coming up, DTR. Can UCLA and Oregon and some of these other Pac-12 teams stand to playoff hunt? And Fowler, quit taking the bait from Herbie. He's walking you right into the rankings conversation you don't want to be a part of.
Clearly.
You're right, Matt. I'm not uncomfortable. I don't find it compelling what America thinks I'm who the top four are right
can
now.
Can I join that camp with you?
And off and bulldozing straight ahead for a short gain. Well, we're getting a look at Alabama and LSU, and after the loss that Tennessee put on them earlier in the year, Bayou Bengals have bounced back, and they beat Alabama. Great position to go to Atlanta and represent the West.
Bear said, this just in for me, he thinks he's hearing Georgia's a 12-point favorite next week.
Wow, he's got early intel from the desert on that one?
Yes. He said that's the look-ahead line for next week. 12.
Does Bear have a headset on down there?
Get your headset.
He's wired up there. We need to get confirmation of that, because that's going to be surprising for people around here to see their team.
Were you surprised when you just heard that?
Yes, I was.
I was.
Very well. Yeah.
I thought it'd be 4, 5, 6. Bear, what are you talking about, 12?
Well, that is the look-ahead line.
What's that mean?
Certain sports books that put a game of the year look-ahead line before the week of the game's actually out there if people want to have a little early action.
Is it a reaction to this game?
No. This was as of like yesterday. So I would think most sports books would probably.
Meanwhile, tonight Levis is going to be sacked yet again at the 2-yard line, and Byron Young has got him again. It's a nightmare for Levis in this Kentucky offense tonight. Thanks to this defense.
Yeah, the get off against Jeremy Flax. It's been a problem all year for Kentucky, and it continues to be a big problem tonight, even when they don't come up with sacks. Watch the get off that Chris talked about earlier with Young. He is so sudden and quick off of the ball. Flax never had a chance at his size to get out there to stop him from getting to his quarterback.
And Flax is not a bad pass protector, okay? They've done really well, actually, this year in pass pro.
Flax has. The team has.
No, but he in particular, he's not the guy that usually gets beat like a drum. D. Williams has space. Williams gets the corner. Still alive. Still down at the 11-yard line. And it's all working for Tennessee tonight. Offense, defense, special teams, crowd, band, Smokey. Everybody's having a great night down here.
Most impressive thing tonight about what Tennessee has done is the juice that they're playing with. This is a game that very easily they could have looked at and been excited about next week. This team, this stadium, like you said, the atmosphere in here, you'd think they're playing for the championship tonight. That is hard to do, to be able to get a team to bring their fastball and play with this kind of passion. Even Smokey doesn't look very impressed.
This is too easy.
He just looks
Smokey
like.
Smokey gets to travel to Uga's house.
They up
down there?
I don't know.
If he
makes that trip or not. He looks bored with the whole thing.
Look at the yards in the second half, Kirk. 5 for Kentucky. Hooker to the end zone. Easy touchdown for Jabari Small. Versatile? Maybe. Emphatic? Certainly.
They slipped him right out of the backfield, trying to get him isolated. Look at that inside route. Took the safety, and the linebacker did not get the depth. Really well designed play. This Tennessee team loves to attack the boundary. See it a lot of times with two receivers. You'll see trips into the boundary. Now they're including the running back. Man, it's tough to prepare for it all.
Aerial coverage brought by Goodyear, celebrating the challenge of road games everywhere. Are you ready for the road? Goodyear, more driven. And here's the home team spotlight, brought to you by Vrbo Vacation Homes. Tennessee just continues to impress. Best start since that championship team we talked about. They just continue to crush records offensively. Going back to last year, it's 11 straight at 30-plus.
That 98 team was so much fun.
Fourth SEC team to go 350 points more in their first 7 games. And the teams that have done that, Bama lost the championship game to Clemson the year they did. LSU, Florida back yep. when Tebow was there. It's been very, very rare in this conference to be this explosive through the first 8 games. Very rare. And the teams that have done it are elite, elite teams. Arian Brown knocked down at the 20. Hey, Matt.
All right, guys, I want to update you on some of the night action. Baylor, Texas Tech, 24-17. That over on ESPN2. That's getting good. And Pittsburgh decided to show up tonight against North Carolina on the road. That on ACC Network, 24-14. And Ole Miss has grabbed the lead back on A&M on SEC Network.
Carolina trying to, just with one loss, trying to navigate the ACC championship game.
Got a little time to kill here. How many players do you think you could name off that 98 Tennessee team off the top of your head?
Well, T. Martin, Price,
Peerless
Alan
Price,
Wilson.
Jamal.
Oops. He's going to miss five. Here's what's interesting. You have a pretty busy schedule. You do your NFL thing on Thursday and fly around. You have high school game on Friday, game day on Saturday morning. You come in here. So I've compared it to what you would do. It's like an Ironman triathlon. But you've ever seen those people that sort of at the end of the Ironman and they're just trying to get to that finish line and they don't know what they're doing or saying? That's why I feel like you're in the fourth quarter. What are you going to throw at me next year?
What? We're just got 7:41 to go here. I mean, it's just one of those games. Yeah, it's been one of those years for us. When we show up, it's typically this type of game, and we get to talk about things like, can you remember the 98 team? I'm going T. Martin. Sean Bryson was a really good player. McCullough, a receiver. Peerless Price,
of course, caught the big
pass. So many good offensive linemen on that team. Al Wilson, Raynock Thompson. See, now it's
Raynock
coming.
Raynock Thompson.
He was a great player. Linebacker.
And all those guys who are looking in will be very pleased with what they see for this Tennessee defense tonight, because it's the overlooked side of the ball here, but they have showed up in a big way, and they have smothered Kentucky. Talked about the game from London, Broncos and the Jaguars, exclusively on ESPN Plus, and then Monday nights, Bengals and Colts. Or Browns, I mean, both teams really needing to win.
Yeah, and awful news about Ja'Marr Chase, who's out. Did not go on the IR, so we'll see how long he is out. But I know you want to have Bear clean up that number for next week. I don't know if he's still down there, but maybe after this play.
I would say clarify, not clean up, because
yeah,
we talked about the early line, Georgia being a huge favorite. Mr. Felica, but that is, clarify that for us.
Can I go former Jet Sean Ellis?
Yes. Oh, my gosh. Sean Ellis.
Chad Clifton,
93.
Offensive lineman.
Clifton.
Let's just fill out the roster like we do at dinner one night when we're just going through like the 85 Cubs lineup.
Exactly.
But no, a lot of sports books will have like look-ahead lines for games, and there probably aren't huge limits on them, but I would expect when the real books in Vegas, Circa will first post an opener tomorrow. I would think it'll probably be Georgia minus.
Now give us a lean.
I'd say Georgia minus 7 or 7.5 or so.
Give us a lean on the game.
That seems more realistic. 12. What? Have you watched Hendon Hooker? 12. That was my reaction to 12.
Yeah, it was like 10 or so like last week, and then it got bet up. But yeah, I think tomorrow when the real opener in Vegas comes out, it'll be right around 7.5. But you have to, that Georgia offense is really good though too.
Yeah.
They dropped like three wide open touchdown passes today. Granted, it was the Florida defense, you know how the emotion of these things work, Kirk.
Yeah.
Like, this is going to be a week where people are really going to be giving Tennessee a huge chance to go to Athens and win, and they probably do have a huge chance to go to Athens and win. And I would expect Georgia to come into that game very motivated. It will take their best effort to win, though. That's for sure.
You imagine that being a tough environment next week?
But again, people want to look at the past and say Georgia's always blasted. Remember that Tennessee made 10 first downs against Alabama last year, right?
Yeah.
Scored 50. It's a different year.
The history doesn't really play with this team, not with what this group's doing. By the way, what I'm taking to Athens with me next week, assuming College Game Day goes there, I'm talking about the Vols defense. I'm going to let you guys take Hendon Hooker and all the records that they're breaking. This Vols defense, man, the depth, the speed, the attitude, they are playing football tonight. Best they've looked all year.
This is LaBelle Wright.
Told you, look at that. Looking good out there.
Barrels to the 50-yard line. What was the Tennessee defense?
DeJohn Terry, good push in the inside all night with the quickness and the size. Amari Thomas, Byron Young's had a great night. Chris told you his story and how he has worked to be in a position to become a star, and they have three interceptions. Slaughter has been all over the field. Really one of the great leaders of this defense, along with Trayvon Flowers. At zero, it seems like every time you look up and Levis is throwing the ball, he's making a play.
Even some guys down the depth chart at running back, some carries here. This is D. Beckwith, carry the ball just twice on the year coming in.
I think he's a former Vol who's now at Kentucky. He's down there on the field before the game. He was visiting with some of the coaches from Tennessee and So that he has a bright future in Lexington.
Talked about Georgia. Georgia also plays Kentucky. Got to go to Lexington there. So Missouri is the next game for the Wildcats. And they got three straight home games to finish it out. Vandy, Georgia. They lost 12 straight to Georgia. And then the rivalry game with Louisville. Beckwith again. And he barrels for a first down. Now, Kentucky, impressive physical drive to answer Tennessee's early touchdown. They missed the PAT and haven't done a thing since on offense, really.
Well, they moved down and then the intercept. They were down in the red zone, down 20-6 in the first half, driving. Looked like a heck of a drive. They were just trying to finish it off and get points. And then Slaughter made that big hit, and they got the interception with Mitchell. And that was really the turning point from that point on. It was all balls.
One of the big storylines tonight, they got Cedric Tillman back, and he's going to be a factor getting better and better for that Georgia game. Marty Jaramillo, our sports injury analyst, can fill us in. They did a procedure him called the tightrope procedure. Marty, explain what was able to mend that high ankle sprain so fast to get Tillman back on the field.
Oh, Chris, this tightrope procedure is a game-changing procedure. They take these two orthopedic zip ties, thick suture material. Not only does it accelerate the healing by stabilizing the ankle, but can also prevent the high ankle sprain in the future.
I'll show you after this play what Marty's talking about. Kind of a look at the two bones in the leg. There's that zip tie.
They take two of those, right? And you see how the ankle got stabilized there. It accelerates the healing of that ligament that was sprained during the injury that he had. And it's a game-changing procedure that'll be many orthopedic surgeons around the country will be learning about this. It'll be a staple for the elite athletes.
Yeah, because Tua Tagovailoa was the guy that made that famous. But you know, you got to be more explosive as a receiver. It's one thing to play quarterback, but you know, he took a little more time to get back because 90% explosiveness, that isn't enough at the receiver position to really make an impact. So,
and he's looked great tonight. He's been making cuts and
got him involved early.
Like I said, you're talking about the leader of the room of these wide receivers. While Hyatt's gotten a lot of attention, and he should because of all the numbers he's put up, Brew McCoy's out there, but really Tillman, who came all the way to Knoxville through Bishop Gorman in Las Vegas, a high school powerhouse, he's the guy. You know how it is when your alpha's out and you're still putting up those numbers. Imagine what it's going to be like when you get him back in, and that's what we've seen tonight.
Final minute now, 4th and 9. Inside screen, Harris fighting and chooses to run out of bounds short of the marker on 4th down. Okay. Maybe you didn't see it. Tennessee will take over. 44 seconds play. 44-6. So this would be the definition of mop-up duty. Joe Milton, one time a starter at Michigan, the starter here until he got hurt. And handed off a couple times before it's over.
Yeah, I live in Nashville. My kids went to Montgomery Bell Academy. Three of them did. And big Jackson Lampley is now in the game. There's Montgomery Bell Academy kids throughout the this region, and there's a few on this team, and it's cool to see Bubba get an opportunity here late in this game to play. Of course, his dad played here, played on some of those teams in the late 90s, early 2000s, some of those great teams, and it's cool to see him get a chance to get in the game.
Tennessee dominates their border rivals and rolls into Athens. It'll be a showdown, one of the showcase games of the season. Two unbeatens colliding. Well, the party continues on Rocky Top. It was fun to be a part of it. We enjoyed the atmosphere. Bill Bunnell directed or produced the game. Derek Mobley directed it. He's claimed the Wildcat. Raleigh Rowe.
You're the one that needs help to
Bill Lamagne, Chris Felica, Kerbstreet, entire crew. So long. from Rocky Top. Now Stanford and UCLA on the West Coast taking out of Dave Fleming. Dave?